guests with us. We're delighted that we can use that term, guest, meaning that you're here maybe for the first time, and that we'll welcome you, and we want you to come back. And we hope that you'll participate fully in the service. We've had a good service thus far. Announcements about the practical, ongoing things of the family of God here. We've had singing. It's been stirring to us, and we thank both for that. And for a minute, the Lord's table, focusing our thinking, and hopefully our lives. And I want to talk with you today about sacrifice, the key to victory. What we really discovered that we really want in life is that for which we're willing to give everything, give our all, give our best, a total commitment to something that we know is so valuable, it's beyond estimation. And as a result of that, to be a kind of a person that has a sense that this is what God wishes for everyone. I want to go to the letter that Paul wrote to Timothy, a beloved young gospel preacher. A great example to the young, and a stirring example to those that were older. Those that had been in the fire and the flame and the difficulty and the hardship. And to have someone like Timothy, a young man, who could teach them and everybody else some lessons that they needed to learn. Paul wrote to Timothy, and in the sixth chapter of 1 Timothy, he says, "But thou, O man of God," what a grand picture for a preacher. "But thou, O man of God, flee these things." He's just listed a number of things. "They that would be rich fall into temptation and a snare," verse 9. "Hurtful lusts drown men in destruction and perdition. For the love of money is root of all evil, which while some coveted after they have erred from the faith and themselves in the things are. But thou, O man of God," you trim down your focus and you get yourself totally committed for the battle. This is language for heroes and those who want to be influenced by it. "Thou, man of God, flee these things and follow after righteousness, godliness, faith, love, patience, meekness. Fight the good fight of faith, lay hold on eternal life, whereunto thou art also called and hast professed a good confession before many witnesses. And this charge in the sight of God," he says, "I'm giving you, who quickeneth all things, and before Jesus Christ, who before Pontius Pilate witnessed a good confession." I want to talk about sacrifice, the key to victory. In the military, metaphors abound throughout the New Testament. We're in a war. And when you're really listening, and when you're really listening and looking, and then you're thinking, you can see it is a war. It smells that way. It echoes and reechoes of the sounds that make it that way. We're in a battle. We're part of the struggle. And I want to share some things like Paul writing to the Corinthians. And he urges them to understand that sacrifice, willingness to sacrifice your all and even your life, that's the hallmark of a soldier. So many things in all of our lives were paid for by somebody else. And when we really look around and see these things, and we take note of them and want to learn from these things, like my grandfather, as a little boy, he used to like to sing two or three little songs, you know. And I'd sit up on his lap, and he used to sing this song. "Grandpa, I want to be a soldier. Soldier's life for me. I'll put Daddy's gun on my shoulder and I'll fight for liberty." I gather later that it was grandfather singing, "If you please, to God's son that had given his life for the country." did it because it had to be done. Or cut and run. The figure then comes home to us as Christians. Sacrifice the key to victory. In 2 Corinthians, the Apostle Paul in the 10th chapter has a third leadership we need to give attention to. For we walk in the flesh, but we do not war after the flesh. For the weapons of our warfare are not carnal, but mighty through God to the pulling down strongholds. You get your mind thinking, you see, we're rushing in, pulling down these walls, mounting up, capturing, eliminating the enemy. He speaks. Oh, they're mighty through God to the casting down of imaginations and every high thing that exalts itself against the knowledge of God, and bringing into captivity every thought to the obedience of Christ, and having in a readiness to revenge all disobedience when your obedience is fulfilled. What he says is, military veterans, we're in a war. And we can look back at 1 Timothy 6, 12 and see that again. The enemy is strong. Be sober, Peter says. Be vigilant, for your adversary, the devil, as a roaring lion, walking about, seeking whom he can devour. Now, I can remember as a little boy, MGM, the movie makers, had this thing at the beginning, and you may laugh at it, but I was just so naive and innocent and young. And when that lion roared, that looked to see if anybody saw it. Your adversary, the devil, that is a roaring lion, walketh about seeking whom he may devour, whom resist steadfast in the faith, knowing that the same kind of things are accomplished in your brethren in the world. You're not alone here on earth, nor from the standpoint of heaven's point of view. Our leader is stronger. We need to be reminded of that. Civilization that could impale an absolutely innocent man. A man who is the son of God on a Roman cross may think, boy, we have really prevailed. But to the astonishment of that time, and even to our time, it does not want to face a truth that, if it is the truth, is so overwhelming. I've got to listen to what this person said. They took his lifeless body down off the cross. It took about 6 hours for him to die, as we can calculate from the accounts. Why? Sometimes it took days and even weeks for some people to die. Why? In 1 John chapter 4 and verse 4, ye are of God, little children, and have overcome them, because greater is he that is in you than he that is in the world. A man who could empty a tomb of himself and put his lifeless body there. And recently I was going out to a rest home and kind of had a little study with someone out there in the Gospel of John, and I found myself being reinvigorated reading those accounts about empty tomb. What happened? Did they move his body? And then slowly grasped it. He's alive. I walked last Sunday. I'm not going to put my hands in. And the man who's empty a tomb and fill the hearts and the lives of individuals with something for which they're willing to live and die. He that is in you is stronger than he that's in the world. These are military metaphors. He is our king. He's given us the weapons with which to fight this battle. Our weapons are mighty. We looked at this just a moment ago and just referred to it again. We are more than who love us, more than conquerors. The interesting thing is that the defeat of someone putting him to death, well, that's a tragedy. That is a immense defeat. But the ability of man to kill Christ is overwhelmed by his ability, capacity, and authority to empty the tomb and fill those who wanted to look at the evidence in their mind and with their emotions and any part of their thinking. Fill it with the conclusion, he's risen from the dead. He kept telling them about why he came and what God wanted him into heaven. And now he gave them evidence to believe. And so the Bible talks about this matter in 1 Corinthians chapter 15 and verse 57. That's a magnificent thing. Yes. That's probably the most doctrinal chapter in the entire Bible. Look at how long it is. Count it. Come on down to the end of it. 58 verses. It's all argumentation for his resurrection from the dead to establish for us that we too will be raised. Just go to the end of that. It tells us in verse 56, the sting of death is sin, and the strength of sin is the law. But thanks be to God, which giveth us the victory through our Lord Jesus Christ. Therefore, my beloved brethren, be as steadfast, unmovable, always abounding in the work of the Lord, for as much as you know that your labor in the Lord is not in vain. In other words, these things all conspire together to give us one conclusion, that is, that we're in a war. And the victory for those who put themselves into this fray, into this commitment, is certain. And certified by an empty tomb and the risen Christ, and evidence that can, to the sincere who will look at it, be overwhelming. Yes, we're all going to die. But because he died and was risen again, we're going to live. And so what this is talking about is that we were born for a battle. And I say it to the youngest, to the oldest here today. It's time for us to drop our toys and take up our weapons for the warfare. We enjoy a lot of things that command our interest and fascinate us and all that, and that's not evil within itself. But we are in war. And when that admiral of the English fleet, and I remember going over to London with my son, was playing soccer, went over there and got stories and everything, and they told us all about the famous admiral. And there's a big statue to him. And he stood on the deck of his boat and said, "England expects every man to do his duty." Child of God must grow up. We need more information on how to grow up and how to stay young. I need more information on how to stay young. But I need to understand what it means to grow up in the service of the Lord. Robert Abraham's, I've never read anything quite like this that meets this. Some men die by shrapnel. Some go down in flames, but most men perish inch by inch and play at little games. All right, to get him to sharpen his spiritual sword and commit his soul and his life and his influence and his example, helping others want to do the same thing. That's why you can say what you will. Nothing to compare with war as putting before us what stops you in your tracks if you think about what's it all about. Yes, what is it all about? The key to victory. Look at this again. Thou therefore, my son, be strong in the grace that is in Christ Jesus, and the things which thou hast heard of me among many witnesses, the same commit thou to faithful men. You teach others. Yes, you teach what comes out of your heart and out of the Word of God. But what is seen in your account? Who shall be able to teach others also? And now therefore endure hardness as a good soldier of Jesus Christ. no man more entangles himself in the affairs of this life, that he may please him who hath chosen him to be a soldier. Stirring stuff. But three things that are essential for victory. Mobilizing our mind. It was said that Winston Churchill, when about World War II, it did produce some marvelous oratory. Almost single-handedly, Winston Churchill lifted the fallen hopes of that empire off on the wings of words. And he said, stirring people, someone had been crouching, if you please, in the bomb shelters and soldiers waiting to face death. He said, we'll win this war. And we'll never surrender. Never surrender. And he said that he mobilized the English language and set it into battle. Set people's hopes and dreams and courage. This is what the Apostle Paul says. Remember this, the shadow of death is creeping slowly and certainly over Paul, who was, I would dare to say, the number one hero of Timothy. And it needs the commitment to the commander. Revelation chapter 17:14. I had that later, but we'll just do it now. John's striking picture of victory gets us all arrayed, our mindset to look at this. These shall make war with the Lamb. Stirring language of the revelation of John. And the Lamb shall overcome them, for he is Lord of lords and King of kings. And they that are with him are called and chosen and faithful. This means war and sacrifice and glory and the price that none can take from us. Sacrifice is the key to victory. Now let me step back and say this. Can any of us say that we are where we are and have what we have, share in what we share, without somebody else? In fact, who are gone before we were born. Sacrifice! Doesn't it make sense? If people are willing to sacrifice their lives for freedom and for decency and for morality and for little boys and little girls so they can be men, live at peace. If that stirs us, surely we're led to understand that we're going to have to be. How can we keep from being stirred by the promise that if we have the courage to submit to the commands and the demands of the commander and take and put on the whole armor of God, that there'll never be any reward that we've ever thought about. And there have been victory parades. I remember in Orlando, Florida, as just a young lad, victory in Europe. Disney World has taken Orlando. And sometimes I have mixed feelings about what has happened to my, what I call hometown. But I've never up to that time seen anything like downtown Orange Avenue, the people had just dumped out of their cars and everything, and there was nothing, no word of move. People were walking over the top of cars, even kissing one another. And it was because they had heard the news that there had been a surrender in Europe. And we all were there celebrating. I'll guarantee you this. Beyond the cheers and the sense of joy, there were people who went back home and they looked again. They looked again at the letter they had come from the War Department. talking about our nation. I love this country. I just wonder if I had lived in some other place. But when Kate Smith used to sing, God bless America, boy, she really could sing. And the question comes, will it keep on? I know my relationship to God is individual, in one sense, but in another sense is collective with my brothers and sisters in Christ. And there's a sense in which we have a camaraderie and a relationship to every human being. Christ didn't die for me or you. And our challenge as Christians is to share this message that He gave everything. And we need to be sacrifice. Yes, we do. Back to this. There's a commitment to the commander, and duty and difficulty, they come together. Three things Paul urges upon Timothy and others: stand. Having it done all, stand. I hope, I pray. You and for me, that we will have to take stands. Have to take stands for what is right and what is different, what is good. What is always morally defensible. Must I be carried to the skies on flowers and beds of ease while others fought to gain the prize and sail through mighty seas? The nature of man is being moral. God has made us that way. We may try to push it out of us, to kill it, to overwhelm it, but we're moral beings. And the sickness of our time becomes more worse and worse when we cannot see the beauty of morality. And that we are not critters, if you please, just creatures, critters, things that have just happened as a result of some unguided force. But as we had a good discussion in Bible class this morning about Kevin and what's his wife. If we are not real acquainted with, all of us and each of us need to get reacquainted and certainly solidly acquainted with it. There is a place called heaven. I pray that I can see it. Do we believe that the Father waits over the way to give us that blessing? The cost of all this, exemplified by Christ, was sacrifice before a wild and angry crew, having the Son of God debased public way, just in what was shameful and awful. But He taught us that the way to triumph is sacrifice. Three things Paul urges upon Timothy to be standing for something. In sharing this, he talks about going on preaching and sharing with others, and then sacrificing. The willingness to sacrifice. This is a lesson. God offers opportunities to the heroes. We see our youngsters, they see that people stand up and cheer all the time. So there's a sense in which you come in, well, I like to, and then why is it, I want to be. Sacrifice. ponder this over after many years is this. Congregations, Lord, people do not exist except somebody sacrificed. We do not have things in our lives that bring us a sense of gladness and appreciation. I think it was, did we have 15 really in our house with all the kids coming in from different places? And it's hard to walk through the house without stepping on something. And what you realize is that, and I try to think of this, I should think more often, John just wasn't much of a fellow. Until I knew the Lord. That's from my heart. She gave me, I already had a reason to live. Because of Christ, I had to obey the true gospel. But he gave me more reason. And what I would have ever attempted or thought about, I was thinking, could I be a preacher? I thought about that. But I'll say this, that the more I thought about it, and then with Ruth's influence and all that, the rest of the story is more specific. And I can preach. And then one of the greatest things of all, and I can't emphasize it enough, is your children. I didn't know what a mother was like, really, because I lost my mother, but Ruth taught me all of that. And what I learned about motherhood, what I learned about any kind of thing that is worth anything, is that this sacrifice is made. And when your fire is lit so that you want to do what you know you have to do, you must do it, you cannot dodge it. You're learning. The heroes are never made without sacrifice. And there's nothing in all of human experience that offers us the opportunity of being able to achieve something through the grace of Almighty God which can ultimately and finally be taken away from you. That's what deep down in the resources of souls of human beings is what they want. They may think it's a pipe dream, and they may just miss the word of God, and they just, and it's not that because they couldn't think. And God would judge on whether or not they wanted to or not. But I must wrap this up by leaving one idea. Especially for others, is walking in the steps of Jesus. And the truth of the matter is, a congregation like Helena, our dream and our desire should be to so sacrifice ourselves for others. Sounds like sure folly to the self-centered. That they must be. And the truth is, I said, well, what am I going to have to, what am I going to have to do? What am I going to have to give up? And the answer is everything. What do you mean? Now, my will is waiting with Christ. Not just me, but others. Not what hurts me and troubles me and disappoints me, but what hurt and troubles and disappoints other people. And to say, the world, let there be peace in our homes, let there be peace in our congregation, and let it begin. again with me. That's why Paul told Timothy that the victory is a result of sacrifice. Why am I saying this? Is there somebody here this morning who wants life to thinking you're even making decisions and thinking about where you're going to go, but you realize that you must push to the top the most important decision of all? Someone says you can't be sure about any tomorrow. Yes, you can. That's what, when something happens, an accident, or somebody dies, we say, well, I wish that. But the truth of the matter is, nobody's ready to live until they're ready to die. Not just die, but certain about what it all means, how it all comes out. Bible teaches that Jesus died, and buried, and was raised, and he came forth from the tomb, and he promises us that we're all going to die sometime. But we're going to be alive, too. And more alive than we've ever thought about in this physical existence. And he offers that to us. We had a good discussion today about heaven and about the situation there in heaven, don't we? But you're not going to find any place the solution that God provides for us in his church now and forever. That is the assurance that if any of us are lost today, like the little boy said, over here his mother said, well, I lost my mother, and the little boy said, Mommy, I thought you said that your mother was in heaven. Why do you keep saying she's lost? And she immediately apologized to the child and said, the child is the father of the man. Is there somebody here today who wants to take up the challenge of sacrifice? Say, I want to be a Christian. I want to commit myself wholly to heaven. Totally. I want to do as Jesus said. He said, he that believes and is baptized shall be saved. He died so that he must see that. And you could take a hold of it as a challenge. As a penitent believer, would you confess your faith in Christ to be baptized for his sins? And if you're a child of God, somehow you have this nagging awareness. I don't know that I've made the price of sacrifice. I've put other things first. If you feel that needs to be public, so that you may have the encouragement